Oh, daughters of Zion. Oh, Abraham's sons. Hear the words of your father. Hear his promise of love. I will make you a blessing. So count the stars if you can. You will be a great nation. I will give you this land. I will bring you back home. I'll bring you back home, oh my children. You will no longer roam, lost and alone in the night. There is nothing on earth that could take you away. Once I gather you under my wings, I will bring you all back home again. Though you've wandered like strangers to the ends of the earth, I will send you. But don't fear, oh my daughters, or sons of Abraham. For I will wash you with water. I will offer the lamb. Though your sins were like scarlet, they'll be whiter than snow.
Hello, my friend. Glad to see you made it. For I have gathered here today in the name of Jesus Christ. Glory be to God. He is alive. He's a living God. A living spirit. For 8 years, we allowed our house to be used by God by placing scriptures upon our house, as you can see. And we've been cleaning the house and painting the house and getting it ready to be used once again for the will of God. We took the opportunity to be a beacon of light for God during these last 8 years, and as a result of those last 8 years, you know, there's been no mass shootings at that particular school that we are front entrance right into the school. High school, junior high, right in our backyard. Our house is the corner house as you enter into it. And every eye in this city and every child saw something. They saw scripture, and once you read it, you can't unread it. But most importantly, what they saw is never be ashamed to have faith in Jesus Christ. That's not something that we should be ashamed of. You know, no matter who we are, whether we're mountain men, city folk, doctors, lawyers, congressmen, presidents, homeless, no matter who we are, we all have one thing in common. And that is the Lord of heaven, the Lord of earth, the God of heaven, the God of earth, the Lord of your salvation, the God of your salvation, desires us, the people of this world. I mean, many people throughout all history have all agreed on one thing. There's got to be a purpose to this. What good is life if the only outcome is death itself? What good is it? And how precious is it when it's so short? I look at how people love this world and the buildings. One of the most heartbreaking thing we as a family here where we live had to face was covering those scriptures. So we just painted the house. It's heartbreaking. Because it is, they are living words. Those words mean everything to us. It's the living word of God and the power of them, whether they're written on the wall, they're written in our heart. It's amazing. We're very grateful that God allowed us to be used. Nobody, even the people in the Bible, nobody did anything, wrote anything, or proclaimed anything about God unless the Holy Spirit of God was moving them and we know today that Jesus Christ is the light of all men, of all people, and that light is life, and some choose not to believe it. And I don't think it's that they choose not to believe it. I think they've been blinded in such a way that it has become impossible to believe unless they see it for themselves. And yet every eye shall gaze upon Jesus Christ. And when we see him face to face, we all shall be healed. Be healed. It will be transformed. And sure, that transformation begins here in this world as we lay down our willingness to sin. And the only sin truly that is spoken of throughout all the Bible are the fact that there are people who don't believe God loves them. Were you? That's the sin, not believing God loves you. Same with Adam and Eve. Didn't believe in God's love. And thereby they went and allowed themselves to be deceived. It's not that they allowed themselves. The serpent was smarter and more crafty than any other animal. Manipulated them into believing a lie, which produced death. And that God warned them, don't go that route or else you will die. That is the love of God. God loves you. And don't you believe I love you? And what they found out was through the works of their own action, by the power of their own unbelief, they brought upon themselves death. But the story doesn't end there. God covering them, God providing for them mercy, God providing for them wisdom, life. God takes no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but would much rather the wicked turned from their evil ways. Turn from that wickedness. You know, I think it's wicked right now. God doing miracles and showing signs and wonders. Through fires, through earthquake, through horrible diseases. Warning us that outside of His love, we are bankrupt. Outside of our willingness to obey His commands, love as I have loved you, and then gives us a complete living example by which we are to follow. All will be lost. When we begin hanging up the innocent on crosses, burning them to death, the innocent, the righteous, good. We see it today that there are people who have been placed in positions to rule over us who want us to believe that they have the power to make laws, yet are above the very laws they make for us to all follow. And they rob and they steal. And they manipulate, and we know Satan came into this world only to steal, only to kill, and to destroy. That's what the devil does. And then want you to believe that if you punish me, 7 times the wrath of God will be rained out on you. It's like Cain and Abel. If anybody tries to get revenge for what Cain has done to his brother, and what Cain did to his brother was clearly murder him. But if anyone tries to avenge his innocent brother's death, 7 times what is supposed to be given to Cain will be rained upon that person. And isn't that exactly what some of our government officials want us to believe? The police want you to believe? That anybody who surrenders their will and their lives to the government cannot be held accountable for their own actions. And we must suffer through that, carry that burden. I'm not saying all are bad. The time is coming when all good may die. We got, I believe, communist terrorists starting and burning down Colorado, California, Oregon, Seattle, and many other places, creating and starting these fires in order to steal our hope. Hunting in Colorado is completely canceled. You cannot go into the national forest because everybody who goes into the national forest has took it upon themselves to create some of the largest fires in history. Burning down cities and towns and homes. And nothing can stop it. Also, we look into the evening sun only to see the smoke billowing throughout all the mountains, everything we hold dear. Crashing our economy. Come to kill, steal, and destroy. Destroying our government. Destroying our trust. The work of God. What is the work of God that we should adhere to? Believe in the one God sent from heaven. Believe in Jesus Christ. And when we say believe in, trust in Jesus Christ. Rest in Jesus Christ. This is the work of God. And Jesus says, it's not my will, but it is the will of God. I came into the world to give you life to the fullest, so that your cup may overflow, overrun, and that life is eternal life. And this is the will of God. And this is why he gave Jesus the authority and the command to perform this, because he was blameless and without sin. He was uncorruptible. And so he did the will of God. We were once a people without hope. We were once a people whom it was said we were cursed. But now we have hope. And we are no longer cursed. Because we are a people with God. And our hope is in Jesus Christ. Our trust is in Jesus Christ. Christ crucified, one death, one Lord, one baptism, one spirit, one body, the body of Christ. And we know God is just. We know God is just. And that's the reason we all die. Because it's in our death the wrath of God is justified. But the gift of God is eternal life. And this is a faith given to us by God. That's the gift. Jesus Christ being able, endowed, empowered to put our faith in Christ. To put our trust in Him. He is the atonement for our sins. I have to remind you, there was a man hanging with Jesus on the cross. There was two thieves, two robbers. And the one robber and all of the crowd was mocking him. He could save sinners, but he can't save himself. He could heal cripples, but he can't heal himself. He could do mighty miracles, but he can't heal himself. And we got to recognize and understand the atonement for our sin. It was through His silence we gained love and willing to condemn. Jesus is clear. I did not come into the world to condemn, but to save. One of the robbers saying, I am justly hanging here. God has justified Himself. You have justified yourselves by hanging me here. My crimes are worthy of it. But this guy has done nothing wrong. This guy is innocent. Surely this guy is the Son of the Living God. Now he doesn't have an opportunity to climb down off the cross and repent of his sins and repay those whom he robbed. But when you enter your kingdom, remember me. That was enough. That was enough. Will you remember me? All things have been created by God. And if God is in our presence, if two or more people gather together by the power of His name, there Jesus Christ is. And if Jesus Christ is in our presence, and God saying, I cannot be inside or around anything unholy, wicked, or evil because I am righteous, just, and good. What does that say about you? Him being in our presence. Isn't it God's seal of approval? Maybe it's us. Maybe it's us who can't come to grips with believing that Christ has washed us clean. Washed us clean. Who will give more gratitude to God? Who will praise God more? The one who has been forgiven a great amount of sin? Or the one who has been forgiven a small amount of sin? In the same way a banker says to a man who owes him $500,000, The man has nothing of worth, of value. He cannot repay it. It's impossible. Not even if I gave you the life of my mother, my father, my children, my own spouse, and allowed them to slave for you, and gave you everything I owned, I still can't pay the bill. Let's make payments. Or the just banker, let's just forgive the entire debt. Okay. The debt is forgiven. Another man comes and owes the banker $10. And again says, even though as small as it is, I cannot repay you. The banker says, okay, the debt is forgiven. Who will glorify, praise, or be more happy? Surely the man who has the greater debt. That debt that can't be repaid. Those who have been forgiven a lot love a lot. Those who have been forgiven a little usually only love a little. I want to share with you guys the scripture from John chapter 5, verse 19. Jesus speaking. And I bring you scripture because these words are eternal life. And there is no other word that's going to manifest eternal life within our lives. Except for this word. It says, truly, truly, I say to you, and I want to remind you that the Jews were seeking all the more to kill him because he was breaking the Sabbath. He was healing people on the Sabbath day, on a day designated by God for no man to do work, and he was doing work no man could do. And they were angry with him. And he was even calling himself the Son of God, which was making himself equal to God. Truly, I say to you, the Son can do nothing of his own accord, but only what he sees his Father doing. For whatever the Father does, that the Son does likewise. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all that he himself is doing, and greater works than these will he show him, so that you may marvel. For as the Father raises the dead and gives them life, so also the Son gives life to whom he will. We're so wrapped up on repentance or penance. We're so wrapped up on forcing ourselves to pay the price for our own sin. We sometimes discredit the power of God's own will. The same way, America is literally burning down in front of our eyes. Our government is being destroyed right in front of our eyes. Coronavirus and the power of pandemic lies and deception are literally tearing our country apart right in front of our eyes. And there's absolutely what seems to feel as though there is no hope in changing anything for the good, greater good of a greater assembly. Because it's all being torn apart. And there's nothing we can do to stop it. It feels that way. And perhaps it is the will of God. As Jesus reminded those who loved him. It is the will of God that the Son of Man be punished thoroughly for the sins of the world and must be rejected by the elders. I must be rejected by the lawyers. I must be rejected by the rulers. Must be rejected by the priests. The rabbis must be rejected by this world, must be subject to suffering. And they wanted to try and stop it. Peter says, they will not harm you. Unless they walk across my dead body. And all the disciples, all his friends said, Lord, we will protect you. We will prevent them from taking you. You're an innocent man. You do miracles. You're righteous and just. We will protect you. How must the scriptures be fulfilled? You do no such thing. The creation doesn't protect the creator. The creation doesn't provide for the creator. The creation doesn't deliver the deliverer. The creation doesn't produce salvation. Rather, it is the Creator who makes all things possible. No one could prevent the will of God. Because it is the will of God that no man perish, but that all would come to repentance through Jesus Christ. Through Jesus Christ. Jesus is the way, the bread, the life, the water, the truth. Through Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ didn't come into the world to lord over us Godship or salvation, holiness or righteousness. Jesus came into the world to bear our sin, to become like us inside of the state we were in, although he did not sin. And he was blameless, innocent, righteous, and perfect. He bore our sins so that we could become likened to him. He created our image in his own likeness and then became like us.
says, you know, although your sins are red as scarlet, I will remember them no more. One death, one baptism, one life, one spirit, one God, one Lord, one salvation. Christ crucified. This is the mystery been hidden from humanity since the beginning of creation. Christ is alive within you. He is the light of all mankind. Christ crucified. As for the Father raises the dead and gives them life, so also the Son gives life to whom he will. The Father judges no one. The Father judges no one, but has given all judgment to the Son, that all may honor the Son just as they honor the Father. Whoever does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my words and believes him who sent me has eternal life. He does not come into judgment, but has passed from death to life. And Jesus speaking to a group of people whom all claimed to know the way of holiness and obtained it through the Torah or the books of Moses. And Jesus clearly proclaiming, if you love God, then you love me. Because everything written within the Torah and everything received throughout the days of the prophets proclaim this truth. God is love. And if you love God, you are actively loving each other. If you love God, and I don't care who you are, you love me. He who honors the Son honors the Father. You are a living stone, precious to God. Do we honor ourselves with the faith of Christ? The faith of Christ, the trust of God. Do we trust Him? What is trust? You are my son. You are my daughter. Do you trust me? Says the Lord. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my words and believes him who sent me has eternal life. He does not come into judgment, but has passed from death to life. Truly, I say to you, an hour is coming and is now here when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God. When the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God. And we who were once without hope, we who were dead in our sin, have heard the word of God. Faith comes by hearing, and it comes by hearing God's word. The dead. Those who hear will live. For as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son also to have life in himself. Sometimes the only thing keeping anyone from entering into the gates of heaven is our own unbelief that God would have mercy on them. And that mercy came through our death. We act so much like God is so ready to throw us into an eternal fire. But it says, I'm going to throw sin and everything that practices sin. And not only sin and that practices sin, but death itself and everything that causes death, which are the wages of sin. And this is the work of God. This is not the work of man that comes through our desire to repent. This is the work of God. That I will do these things so that you cannot worship an idol, so you cannot love this world more than the Creator. You cannot sin any longer. It's impossible because sin has been destroyed. And we keep saying, when is this going to happen? The moment you believe, it is finished. He goes on to say, for as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son also to have life in himself. And he has given him authority to execute judgment because he is the Son of Man. And what was the judgment Christ brought into the world? He who loves me loves the one who sent me. And I'm telling you, Jesus Christ sent me to you. Forgive. I came into the world to atone for sin. I came into the world to give to you God's promise of forgiveness. This was the execution of the judgment. This is the judgment. God gave you the Lamb who took away the sin of the world so that you could know the love of God endures forever. And that's the truth. Do not marvel at this, for an hour is coming when all who are in the tombs will hear his voice. For we're so ready to condemn everybody, and yet that there is no one without sin, including you, including me. And come out. And those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of judgment. Those who have done good, those who have put their trust and their faith in Jesus Christ, if you love me, then you love God as well. And the light of Christ is the life of all men, the people. To the resurrection of judgment. Because you did not believe, God's love was for you. The resurrection of judgment. Being convicted of your sin by giving to you eternal life. Not because you believed it, but because I am who I say I am. My thoughts are not your thoughts, and my ways are not your ways. For my thoughts are higher than your thoughts, and my ways are above your ways, as the heavens are above the earth. I have the power to pardon sin. We, the people of flesh, sometimes struggle with that power. By not forgiving sin. You are forgiven. You have been forgiven. And the judgment, that when that becomes a reality, how can you deny the goodness of God? It's impossible. I can do nothing on my own. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just because I seek not my own will, but the will of him who sent me. If I alone bear witness about myself, my testimony is not true. There is another who bears witness about me, and I know that the testimony that he bears about me is true. You sent to John, and he has borne witness to the truth. Not that the testimony that I receive is from man, but you say these things so that you may be saved. But I say these things so that you may be saved. He was also a burning lamp, a shining light, and you were willing to rejoice for a while in his light. But the testimony that I have is greater than that of John, for the works that the Father has given me to accomplish, the very works that I am doing, bear witness about me that the Father has sent me. And the Father who sent me has himself borne witness about me. His voice you have never heard. His form you have never seen. And you do not have his word abiding in you, for you do not believe in the one whom he has sent. You search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life, and it is they that bear witness about me. Yet you refuse to come to me that you may have life. I do not receive glory from people, but I know that you do not have the love of God within you. I have come in my Father's name, and you do not receive me. If another comes in his own name, you will receive him. How can you believe when you receive glory from another and do not seek the glory that comes from the only God? Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father. There is one who accuses you, Moses, whom you have set your hope. For if you believed Moses, you would have believed me, for he wrote of me. But if you do not believe his writings, how will you believe my words? So what Jesus is clearly saying is, words absent of action are dead. Words absent of action are dead. And Jesus saying, the action, the evidence, the miracles God is doing through me is the evidence of God's presence with you. He did the work no one could do. And he did it on a day. On a day that God made for our rest. He said, I came into the world to manifest God's will. And he kept telling them, and telling them, and telling them, and telling them. It is the will of God that you experience his eternal life with joy and gladness. He who loves me loves God, the one who sent me.
I will
know.